All right. Hey, everyone. Welcome to today's episode of the Pop Music Books in Process series, a collaboration between the Journal of Popular Music Studies, IASPM US, and the Pop Conference. My name is Gus Stadler, and I co-organize the series along with Kimberly Mack, Antonia Randolph, Francesca Royster, Carl Wilson, as well as series founder Eric Weisbard, who's currently on sabbatical abroad in a time zone that makes it difficult for him to attend the meetings. If you're not on our mailing list but would like to be, please email Francesca Royster at froyster at depaul.edu, froyster. Also, you can see previous episodes on Eric Weisbard's YouTube channel. Just go to YouTube and search Eric Weisbard and they'll come up. There's over 100 of them, I think, now. We're meeting this fall pretty much every week on this day and time. Next week, we'll have Ray Padgett, the writer Ray Padgett, who has just published a book called Pledging My Time, Conversations with Bob Dylan Band Members. And now I'm going to introduce today's speakers. Jonathan Leal is an author, composer, and scholar based in Los Angeles, California, originally from the Rio Grande Valley, the South Texas region located at the border of the United States and Mexico. Leal creates writing, music. Wait, can I just check? Am I pronouncing it right, Jonathan? I'm sorry, I should have asked you before.
No worries, it's Leal.
Leal, okay. Leal creates writing, music, and collaborative arts projects that span issues of borders and memory, race and media, place and belonging, technology and aesthetics, and creative and political practices. Leal's musical projects have been featured in Pitchfork, Democracy Now!, Texas Monthly, Remezcla, Latino USA, and elsewhere. His public writing has appeared in the Los Angeles Times, Los Angeles Review of Books, The Rumpus, San Francisco Classical Voice, and elsewhere. And his scholarship in theoretical works have appeared in the Journal of Popular Music Studies, ASAP Journal, Critical Studies in Improvisation, Rio Bravo, Journal of the Borderlands, and many other venues. He's currently an associate editor of the Field Notes section of the Journal of Popular Music Studies. In addition to the book that he's discussing with us today, the recently published Dreams in Double Time, Leal is co-editor of Cybermedia Explorations in Science, Sound, and Vision from Bloomsbury in 2021. And he's currently completing a new book-length project entitled Wild Tongue, a Borderlands Mixtape. Leal is an assistant professor in the Department of English at the University of Southern California. Jonathan's interlocutor is Nate Sloan. Nate Sloan is a musicologist and performer who researches jazz, Tin Pan Alley, and popular music. Sloan hosts Switched on Pop with songwriter Charlie Harding, a podcast produced by Vox Media, which has been cited by Rolling Stone, The Guardian, and Entertainment Weekly as a top music podcast. And he provides music analysis for The Economist, NPR, The Atlantic, The Boston Globe, and CBC Radio's Day 6. Sloan's vaudeville duo, The Gideon and Hubcap Show, has played at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival and London Soho Theater. He also composes for theater and film, including the score for the short documentary Slow Mo, and performs in the Dave Harrington Group. Nate Sloan also has professional experience as a consulting musicological expert in copyright litigation and clearance. So after the conversation between Jonathan and Nate, which will probably run about 45, 50 minutes, we'll open up for Q&A with everyone here, which Carl will moderate. So please put your questions in the chat as they come to you. And when the time comes, Carl will call on you and ask you to unmute and ask your question directly to the speakers. Also, please feel free to use the chat to share comments or observations as the talks proceed. And I'll just remind the presenters to not look at the chat because it will distract you. And now I will turn things over to our presenters, Jonathan and Nate. Take it away.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Gus. Let me share my screen before I really get started. Okay, can everybody see that? Yeah, awesome. Well, thank you, and thank you all for being here today. It's really great to see some familiar faces and some new faces as well. Much gratitude to all of the organizers who made this event happen, as well as to Nate for being game to engage with me today. Many thanks to the team at Duke University Press, Ken Wissaker, and the editors of the Refiguring American Music Series, Ronald Redano, Josh Kuhn, and Nina Eitzheim. The whole village of people who helped make this book possible and who have supported me over the years, and I can see Charlie Cronengold here in the audience, which makes me really happy. I'm so excited to be part of the series this year and to be in dialogue with all of you. What I'm going to do today is read two excerpts from the book, which will be accompanied by some images and some sounds, and all of that will add up to just shy of 20 minutes. But before I get into that, I do want to frame the book just a little bit. So Dreams in Double Time is nominally about the music that came to be called bebop, about the people who made it and how it traveled, about how it influenced a number of differently positioned and racialized listeners. But the book's unifying frame story, the story that begins and ends the book and is also woven throughout it, is a story about my musical connections with my late grandfather, Octaviano, who was also a musician. In the mid-1950s, he attended the North Texas State College of Music to study saxophone, and he played with a lot of the folks in the now storied 1 o'clock lab band when it was just getting started as an institution. And coincidentally, it's also where I went to music school some 50 years later, hoping to study some of the same things. So the frame of Dreams in Double Time involves my working to listen alongside my grandfather, particularly during the pandemic and in the wake of his death in 2021. As a whole, the book lives for me in this kind of ever-evolving relationship between our present moment and what we call the past, and specifically the people who mediate that relationship. So I'll just get started here now. Among the CDs and long-playing records in my late grandfather's personal music collection, eclectic and piecemeal as it was, there once lived a crisp reissue of Bird and Prez, Jazz at the Philharmonic. A Norman Grant's production recorded in 1946, nearly 2,000 miles from my grandfather's home at the border of the U.S. and Mexico, nearly 3,000 from Harlem, there in the late-night glamour of a storied auditorium that once marked the heart of Los Angeles. I'm listening to this recording now, seated on a metal bench in Pershing Square, a stone's throw away from where that concert took place, baking in midday autumn warmth. Laserdisc spinning, headphones ablaze, my mind drifts between layers of sedimented time, retracing routes of musical travel and noting amid the din of overhead helicopters and the twists of Charlie Parker's solo on Lady Be Good, the energies linking our generations, the sounds drawing memory close. Take a listen. After the opening applause, after Arnold Voss's loping piano instrumental, after the first portion of Charlie Parker's blue shaped solo, after you click seamlessly into double time against Billy Hadnock's rapping bass line, note the nested micro-rhythms dreaming against the established pulse, every downbeat cracked and shimmering like broken glass in the network. How Parker's infectious rhythmic sensibility nudges the accompanying musicians ahead slightly, energizing them to a forward lean. With the drop that immediately follows the solo's end, played by a bass teacher, intersects giant Lester Young's reluctant to sign the Parker's closely. Nate Young's eventual step out, his bubbly tone, his contrast with Parker's style, and with his resonance with it. The second Jazz at the Philharmonic concert, of which this moment is part, marks one of the earliest major West Coast performances of what was by then known as bebop. The now storied lineup of musicians, including Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie, who had traveled westward a few months after the war's end, eager to see what new dimensions of their insurgent musical vocabulary were coming. Today, for me, the recording of this concert not only serves as a new connection to this lettered coastal city, long its own dream factory, but also to my grandfather's life, as well as to some of the awakenings that this East Coast vocabulary made possible for this generation. In Dreams in Double Time, I listen alongside my grandfather, as well as relationally, alongside a cluster of musicians from his generational cohort, to sustain some questions grounded in relational cultural study. Why was a radical avant-garde music, a wartime idiom created after hours by Black experimentalists in 1940s Harlem jam sessions, so generative for young, differently racialized non-white listeners during the global realignments of the post-war years? How is it that the dreams encoded in Bebop, specific to African-American experiences, came to transform the lives of differently racialized listeners as they dealt daily with the violences of state and national power? What might a focus on the other colors of American undergrounds teach artists and scholars about the pasts and potentials of post-national American dreaming? What kinds of futures can relational histories of musical engagement create? To sketch some answers to these questions, this book entwines my own scenes of remembrance with three stories, three audiobiographical narratives, to borrow Rahsaan Roland Kirk's phrase of the audiobiographical, of ostensibly minor figures in American music. James Araki on the left, Raúl Salinas in the center, and Harold Wing on the right. These stories, much like my grandfather's own, loop and intersect, overlap and interweave. My grandfather didn't know these three figures, never played with them or listened to their music, but I would like to think they would have gotten along, would have bonded over their shared sounds and mutual interests. Together, all of their stories, specific as they are, evoke for me a sense of interplay, a sense of a moment greater than the sum of its parts. The first figure, James T. Araki, was a Japanese-American multi-instrumentalist among many things. He was interned with his family at the Gila River War Relocation Center under Executive Order 9066, and was by many accounts a prodigy performer and composer who as a young man found inspiration in the pioneers of Harlem's new sound. Shortly after hearing bebop musicians perform in the mid-1940s, he was drafted into the U.S. Army and was stationed in a war-ravaged, newly occupied Japan as a soldier-translator. By day, he translated government documents between English and Japanese, and by night, he played for jazz for American soldiers, seeking entertainment along the Ginza in Tokyo, and particularly bebop for Black American soldiers requesting it. Latching onto the complexities of the new sound's architectures, Araki incorporated its features into his playing, and in effect, he is now credited by Japanese jazz historians as having helped spread bebop to Japan. As an example of his work, here's a snippet of a tune that he wrote and recorded with a group in Japan in the late 1940s, which features him on saxophone. As I was transcribing the solo a few years ago, one of the fascinating things I realized is that it features a direct Charlie Parker citation by way of a lick that Parker played on a large number of his recorded improvisations. And so to get that sound in our ears, here are four examples of that lick from different Charlie Parker recordings. That lick, here's it again. And again on Anthropology. And once again on Dexterity. And here it is in Araki solo, and the Parker lick is highlighted here. One of the things I think through in this book is moments like this, specific and complicated acts of trying to think alongside musicians that are much admired. In this case, trying to think alongside Charlie Parker in late 1940s Japan as a 22-year-old formerly interned Japanese-American member of the Allied Occupational Force. What do our histories open out into if we're attuning ourselves to stories like this, if we're listening for relationally for stories like this? Now, when Araki returned to the United States from Japan in the 1950s, he enrolled in college at the University of California, Los Angeles under the GI Bill, completing studies in Japanese literature, folklore, and translation while performing and recording with other professional musicians active in SoCal's energizing scenes, including Lionel Hampton and Buddy Rich. Now, at the same time, also active in those California scenes was a young Raúl Salinas. a Mexican-American proto-hipster raised in East Austin and working seasonally in California with his family. After being arrested for drug distribution, and as it happens, after being detained in an LA County facility at the same time as famed tenor saxophonist Dexter Gordon, and here on the right is a reflection of Salinas's from his papers in the Stanford Special Collections about that. Salinas began a prison odyssey that lasted through the 1960s, or all of his 20s, essentially, penning poems from behind the bars of these four prisons that would ultimately yield a new and intermedial mode of Chicano literary expression, a mode infused with an improvisatory sensibility that was distinct from most beats, finding form in work that he produced throughout the rest of his writing life. Just to give a little bit of a sense of this, this is the second poem he ever wrote, and he wrote it in prison, written as a blues verse and dedicated to the memory of Charlie Parker. And we can return to this later if we'd like to. This is a mantra that Salinas attributed to Thelonious Monk while serving time in a situation that he perceived to be very unjust. Beyond justice, everything gets complicated. And here is part of a shelved collection of jazz writings that Salinas called Jazz Jaunts, which was at one point slated to be his follow-up to a book that changed Chicano literature, When Trip Through the Mind Jail. Now, before Salinas set down Jazz Jaunts, set it aside in the 1970s, he had dedicated it, among a number of people, to an Afro-Chinese American drummer named Harold Wing, or as he introduced himself to Salinas in the 1950s as Chink Williams, a nom de musique built upon his own reclaiming of a racial pejorative. Based largely in Newark, New Jersey, Wing was a drummer, a pianist, and a songwriter who, as a young man, collaborated with a number of Bebop's architects, including Charlie Parker. And here's a flyer for a concert in Newark, New Jersey that lists Wing as Parker's drummer. As well as Dizzy Gillespie, Bud Powell, Miles Davis, Errol Garner, Babs Gonzalez, James Moody, Sarah Vaughan, and international star Ella Fitzgerald, even at one point writing and recording a song with Ella Fitzgerald that was recorded with the Cy Oliver Orchestra. Wing was a consummate modernist and an evident pragmatist, and was always working to find ways to wed the radical and the practical in his music. Experimenting through his song arrangements, his drumming, and eventually his work in Newark City Hall as the music director, with ways to make communal change happen, particularly in the years immediately following the 1967 uprisings in Newark. Now, in isolation, stories like these illumine matters important to Chicanx, African American, Asian American, and many other aesthetic and political histories. But what I'm doing in the book is arguing that when we consider them together, they produce a surplus revealing of deeper post-war thought and feeling, as well as maybe an intimate prehistory of revolutionary coalitional struggles for social justice in the 1960s and 70s. When we listen to bebop relationally across these stories, we can hear the ways an underground spirit was modulated across disparate scenes and non-white communities, the ways it afforded a generation of young people new opportunities to challenge the racial norms of the wartime United States by embracing a unity in difference, a mode of connecting in relation. In effect, by focusing on ostensibly minor figures and materials, this book's stories work against a larger backdrop of histories that are devoted to jazz masters, as well as a cultural tendency to narrate the history of bebop largely through a black-white binary. It attends to listeners for whom this black-centered musical revolution proposed different ways of being in the world, for whom it became an affectively and intellectually powerful force, for whom it offered a symbolic language critical of the larger forces of governmental, state-sanctioned imperialism, for whom it challenged the totalizing singularity of whiteness during the second half of the 20th century, and really for whom it offered opportunities to imagine new critical and artistic forms of confrontation with a racially supremacist imperial nation state emboldened during and after World War II. So shifting now to the second excerpt, which is not as long. As time is warped and shattered amid the suffering of these long pandemic years, I found myself thinking often of my late grandfather, of his saxophone, glinting and silent, which I actually have here for some good luck. Of his handwritten sheet music, his note heads always curiously facing the wrong direction on the page. Of his building a life with my late grandmother, their twilight dancing suggestive of a benevolent universe. He died before I could tell him most of this, before I could follow up with more questions, before we could potentially unearth together some of the journeys of which he seldom spoke. Thinking today about his old vinyl records, albums by his favorite artists, I'm filled with questions I can't answer, only deepen. What did he dream of when he picked up those albums, when he reached for his instrument? What guidance, if any, did he receive from the collective spirit that musicking indexes? What and who should we be listening for today amid so much? What was he listening for all those years ago, studying Black radical music as a young Mexican-American man from the open wound that is the U.S.-Mexico border? Seated again in that park in Pershing Square, my grandfather's personal copy of that Jazz at the Philharmonic concert grounding me, I think again of what it is our dreams can do, what they can encapsulate. In shadows cast by luxury high-rises, I jot down a thought in my notebook. Just as the literal dreams experienced in sleep can tell the subject something about the truth concealed by its days, so too can those figurative dreams and aspirations so entwined with histories of American myth-making. Those theories, speculations, and aspirations revealing of the structures of the everyday. In this once distant place, Los Angeles, with my grandfather's personal copy of a live local album grounding me, the stories of others of his generation inspiring me, I trust in this fully. To ask repeatedly, as a racialized, minoritized subject, both now in this broken present, and then during late night concerts and midnight jam sessions, where is our unfettered dream space, as Elizabeth Alexander puts it, our imaginative plane in which social identity, quote, need not be seen as a constraint, but rather as a way of imagining the self unfettered, racialized, but not delimited, end quote. Asking this is in its own way an effort to conjure unforeseen openings, to turn one's ears to worlds of nonsense, to deliver evaluations and speculations and sound, to find one's dream in the very act of seeking it. One of my arguments in this book is that music can serve and has served as an entry point into critical, improvisatory, boundary-crossing ways of being. For many young people of color coming of age in the 1940s and 50s, in the context of wartime nationalism, amid the violence of racist fantasy, Black radical music cracked open a new cosmos. It moved beyond the productive insularities of Harlem through concerts, recordings, and more, and it revealed a new lexicon to scores of listeners trying to find their own way, a lexicon for thinking through national shortcomings and for conceiving of shared fate. Modified as it was across media, space, tradition, repertoire, and circumstance, this music shape and feeling offered, as Scott Saul once put it, quote, a dynamic sense of freedom to its listeners, a barbed challenge as well as the most exhilarating of invitations, end quote. At once invitation and excoriation, transformative intervention and underground experiment, the music that came to be called bebop once captured and catalyzed dreams of living otherwise. If we follow memory's threads, perhaps it can do so still. And so those are the excerpts. Apologies for going on a little long. Excited to be in conversation with all of you, and I'll stop sharing my screen now.
Thank you for that deeply musical and visual presentation, Jonathan. I think that was a very thorough and enjoyable introduction to the project. If I may, I would like to just quickly say how grateful I am to be asked to interlocute. I'm not sure if that's a verb. This is a series that I've attended a number of these conversations during the pandemic lockdown years. This was such a refuge. This is really exciting and a testament to its organizers that it's continued and provided this place for discourse about research in popular music. So, Jonathan, I am particularly interested in the process of researching a book like this. As you mentioned in your introduction, these are figures at the margins of what is usually considered jazz history. In your book introduction, you cite a number of well-established archives that you've accessed, from the IJS archives at Rutgers University to the Stanford Special Collections. But there's also a lot of sources that you had to gather that required you to leave, you know, your armchair, so to speak, and interview people and uncover historical materials in places that, you know, haven't, where they're not cataloged and digitized, et cetera. So I would love to hear a little bit about the process of gathering information on some of these figures who are relatively obscure, and what were the challenges of uncovering material on to shed light on these figures?
That's a great question, Nate. Thank you. I think I can answer that in two different ways. The first of which being that I think the idea of obscurity is something that is in our sort of academic context mediated by disciplinarity as well, right? And so, for example, a lot of folks who are very much steeped in jazz criticism even, but certainly jazz studies, hadn't heard of Raúl Salinas before. And there are disciplinary reasons for this. Whereas folks who work in Chicano literature and Chicano literature history, he's one of the OGs. He's one of the people who a lot of people cite, right? But a lot of folks in that context don't read his jazz writing. And so his writing was actually the first that I considered for this project a number of years ago. I wrote a seminar paper for a beautiful class taught by Walton Miyumba called Critical. I mean, it was a class on essayists and criticism. So there was that aspect of things that I was negotiating throughout the whole process of researching the book. But then there is the very real pragmatic, practical thing of, you know, you hope to find something and you don't know what you're going to get. One story that I can share is, so I was in the Stanford archives working with Raúl Salinas' papers. I came across that jazz manuscript that he left unfinished and unpublished. And I noticed the dedication, and I had never heard of Harold Wing before. And so I did some digging, and I ended up at Rutgers in Newark to try to get some more information on him. I was filled with excitement getting off the plane because they had a file on him, and I was hoping that it was going to have the answers to all of my questions, the way that maybe anybody who does archival research is hoping. And when I got there and I opened the file, I saw that there was a single sheet of paper, and it was just his obituary. And I had no idea, but I was like, oh, I flew all the way out here and I don't know what I'm doing now. And so I talked to Tad Hirshhorn, who was at the library, and he helped me tremendously. And two nights later, I think I was doing an oral history with Eugene Goldie Goldston, who was a singer in Newark, New Jersey, and a dear friend of Wing's. And he gave me the scoop and told me where to look. I think there's always a mix of dogged perseverance and sheer luck when trying to put any project like this together. And the range of materials I was working with included, audio recordings, liner notes, concert and album reviews. I transcribed solos. I learned how to play some of the transcriptions, cover art, personal letters, short stories, poems, unpublished fragments, news articles, and then those personal interviews. And so that's just the acquiring of the material. And then there's, of course, the putting it into a coherent narrative. And that, I think, that was even harder than finding the material itself.
Yeah, I think I can imagine, like mine, many attendees here had their hearts drop when they heard that story of opening the folder and finding a single page. That's our the academic's equivalent of The Exorcist or something. It's true horror. Now, Jonathan, you talked about disciplinarity. Maybe we can take the conversation to dig into that a little further. Let me see if I can to retell this chronology. You did your undergraduate degree in jazz performance at UNT.
Well, I studied music at UNT. Jazz performance was part of it, but also I did a number of orchestral things. I did a lot of marching percussion stuff. I was kind of all over the place as a percussionist and was doing some creative writing at the same time.
Okay. Okay. But your degree was in music. Is that right?
No. It started as music. It started as music perform. Actually, I was way too ambitious. I was doing music performance, music education, and trying to do composition. And one of the things that, you know, inevitably happens, I think, for folks who have little exposure to what college is actually like, and, you know, what college selections are like, I just realized that it wasn't quite the fit for me at UNT. And there's no shade to that institution. I think it's an amazing place. But I basically created a situation for myself with my advisors that would allow me to keep taking theory classes, composition, be in ensembles, but do a more like independent study style approach.
So you've got this hybrid degree, and then you go to Stanford University and you do the Modern Thought and Literature program. And now you're at USC and you're in English. You have an appointment in English and another department as well, right?
Just in English for now.
Just in English for now. Okay. So there's like a number of different disciplines that you've already skated through. How do you think about bringing those perspectives to bear on a study like this? Is there value in thinking about these figures and their music and their writing and their expression through a disciplinary lens? Do you use different parts of your training to address these figures? Do you try and think beyond discipline? How are you approaching this in terms of, and especially in terms of like what the analytical tools you're using to talk about this music?
That's a great question. So I think that disciplinarity can be a beautiful thing. It can also be a deeply constraining thing. And I think all of us who have any association with a discipline feel that. I don't think it's a unique thing to people who avowedly do interdisciplinary work. And some of the uniquely special things that disciplines give you are, you know, very strong methodological tools. So, you know, through literary study, right, a deep emphasis on historical contextualization as it relates to close reading, for instance, and very various varieties of close reading and how one can think about that. And then, you know, from the more musicological side of things, you know, score study, from the jazz studies tradition, thinking about transcription as a fundamental methodology, and, you know, having to make creative decisions or analytical decisions about, you know, why do I think it's in this meter, right? Why do I think it's in this key? How would I notate this? And what logic am I imposing on this audio that I'm hearing by transcribing it in this way? I think that all of those things are necessary and good. And but for me, I really wanted to try to find a way to create a project that felt akin to the way my grandfather would tell a story. And two, for me, I think for others as well, narrative is fundamentally transdisciplinary. And so if we're thinking about what do you do with all of these discrete analyses that you perform on these different works, how do you create something that makes all of those analyses feel like they have something to do with each other? For me, that came down to, well, I need to tell a good enough story. I need to use the tools that I know from narrative design, from creative writing. And I need to really think about each of these materials, even beyond the disciplinary training, so that I can find the story that's latent within them. So maybe I'll just stop there. I could ramble about this, you know, for ages, but I'd be curious to hear what you guys think as well.
Yeah, no, let's pick up that thread. First of all, I love the what you just said about the idea of narrative transcending discipline. I'm gonna go write that in my special book after this, because that's a good line. So you mentioned foregrounding your own, not only your personal history, but your familiar history. Your grandfather, as you've discussed already, is a key character in this story. I love that when you open the book, one of the first things you see is a photograph of his saxophone. It's a very arresting image, and I think a little unusual to find in a book published by, you know, Duke University Press. I don't know if we're explicitly taught this, but I feel like there's a sentiment that, you know, academic expository writing, you efface yourself to a degree, but you've done the opposite. You've really injected your family story, your personal narrative into this. Why was it important to do that for this project? And was it scary to do that?
It was terrifying. Of course it was terrifying to do that. Yeah. For all the reasons that you mentioned, as well as just the natural terror of putting a personal story out into the world. But certainly in academic contexts, I mean, the traditional wisdom, you know, and it's not necessarily given cynically, but to help folks, is that, you know, the first book should be more straight ahead, and that you can experiment after that. In my case, I didn't know when I was starting this, and certainly when I was getting to the finish line with it, just general anxieties about the future, not knowing how long we're going to be on this planet, not knowing how long I'm going to be alive, thinking about mortality through my grandfather. I just thought, well, if I'm going to make something, I should make something that feels like it's coming from deep within myself, and I want it to appear that way as well in the world. But I also think that there is an emerging spaces through presses like Duke for what's now being called critical nonfiction, you know, for scholars across a variety of different disciplinary domains to experiment with different types of writing styles, not just personal essay, but, you know, also maybe lyric or poetry. And you can see that with some of the most exciting scholars, intellectuals today, Christina Sharp, right? Ordinary Notes, which just came out. I think that if there's one thing that the book and the accompanying single and other work that I've been doing, if there's one thing that unifies all of it, it's a commitment to the idea that that there's no single monopoly on what the form of intellectual practice, the form that it should take, right? I'm happy that I did it. It feels like it was the right thing to do.
So I want to be mindful of the time, and especially because I want to listen to a musical component of this project as well. So I'll either ask one or two more questions before we turn to that music. And if I don't get to both of them, maybe in the general Q&A period, we can get to it. The idea of bebop as a difficult, challenging art form is something that you talked about already. You quoted Scott Saul, it's simultaneously an invitation and a challenge, you know. Mm-hmm. Thelonious Monk said that it was created at Minton's Playhouse by African American musicians as an attempt to generate a music that couldn't be stolen by white band leaders who had been appropriating that sound. Mm-hmm. So part of the difficulty of bebop is not just a musical challenge, but a socio-political one as well. However, when I teach jazz, I find that students seem more invested in the musical complexity of that style without really engaging in the socio-political nature of the music, the liberatory challenge of the music. How can this book reopen a conversation about what bebop can mean beyond this incredibly sophisticated and complex musical language?
That's a really important question. And I have compassion for those students who who are dazzled, you know, by the, you know, the tritone substitutions and the, you know, the rapid phrases and all aspects
the 300 BPM tempos.
Right. I have compassion for those folks. And I mean, sonically, the music is very arresting, right? But as with all things, I mean, we were born into a world we didn't create. We have inheritances that we discover, and it's up to us to understand what to do with those inheritances, right? So as you're saying, right, this music was born after hours at Mitten's Playhouse. And the folks who were creating it, you know, were responding to a mainstream national fantasy of a white dominated monoculture in the context of wartime nationalism. And I think just reminding folks, whether through this book or elsewhere, that was the case, and that these are the stories that accompany these sounds, I think is not only the good historical thing to do, but the ethical thing to do as well. Because to be fascinated by the music and not to understand where it came from is to participate in this very long disgusting tradition of loving the music and not the people who make it, right? Of deracinating the music, of detaching it from folks. And so if there is one thing that this book can do, I think it's maybe contextualize that through these different stories, and maybe also flip that idea of virtuosity on its head. So the final chapter before the coda is called Among Others, and that's the one that's devoted to Harold Wing. And I called it Among Others because he was an accompanist. And you know, often when you see lists of musical contributors on something, you'll have the list of stars, the virtuosi, and then you have Among Others, right, that follows that. And there's a kind of anonymization there and a practicality as well. I mean, you can't just continue to list every single person who plays on something unless you have the space for it. But it also signals that phrase, this idea of collectivities, of communal arrangements, to be among others, to make things among others. And so if that is where the weight of virtuosity is placed, then I think we can maybe even tell some different stories about the music. Right? What does it mean to be communally virtuosic, right? And how does these sounds point us in that direction, as opposed to being the hero on the bandstand and having all of the attention?
Okay, so we'll add communally virtuosic to narrative transcends discipline as another throw pillow. from this talk. Jonathan, we have to listen to some music now. It's time. You, in addition to pushing against some of the norms of you know, as you said, first book publishing, by injecting your personal narrative into this research project, you've also created a companion musical work called Dreams of Autumn, which rearranges the jazz standard Autumn Leaves with an ensemble in which you perform yourself. I'd love to hear a quick introduction to this piece and the role it plays as in relation to the book, and I'm eager to listen to some of it as well.
Awesome. Thank you, Nate. Dreams of Autumn. So as you said, it's a contemporary reimagining of Autumn Leaves. Everybody's done Autumn Leaves, so we had to do it. And one of the things that we wanted to do in even creating it in the first place was to lend musical form to the concepts and the histories in the book. So bridging some of the radical vocabularies of what came to be called bebop with strategies and tendencies that are used in contemporary improvised musics that our group really enjoy. A lot of us came up listening to Bad Plus, Vijay Iyer, Tigran Hamasyan, and so we wanted to make a tune that kind of reflected some of those interests. So let me just see if I can get that going here. It's about 2 minutes of 2 minutes of music. I'm just playing the last half of the tune. Oh, and this was the cover for it, and then this was the personnel. Brandon Guerra was on drums, Jason Galbraith on tenor sax, Sam Pankey, Tyler Jackson and Matt Melly all contributed, and it was recorded in San Antonio, Texas. Yeah, that was the end of the tune.
Hmm. Wow, great. Love that tenor solo.
He's a monster. He's so good.
Left no crumbs, as the kids say. So, well, okay. I'm sure, like me, many people have reactions to hearing that incredible track, but I'm very aware that now is a perfect time to pivot from my questions to the questions of our esteemed audience, questions I'm already seeing in the chat that are incredibly thoughtful and engaging, perhaps questions that people have want to turn up their mics and ask. So I believe Carl will facilitate that now.
Thanks so much, Nate, and thanks to both of you for this presentation so far. We have room, by the way, people in the chat too, for more questions in the next little while. But I might start off just coming off the back of the music to ask Jonathan to talk a little more specifically, now that we've heard it, about what the thematic elements from the book that connected into that piece were, and what you were specifically thinking about.
Yeah, well, this is super, maybe a super nerdy thing, but the book at a formal level is structured kind of essayistically. And so there are moments of present tense reflection and then history, present tense reflection and history. And all of that is framed with this overarching frame narrative, right? And what we were doing with Dreams of Autumn was kind of a similar thing. As folks know, usually with a jazz tune, you'll have maybe an introduction, you'll have the head, and then you'll have people take solos, and then you have the return of the head eventually, and it creates this little sandwich. So there is that, that melody is the kind of present tense melody. But then within that, in the song, there is also the Autumn Leaves direct quotation. And so there is a kind of framing within the structure of the song that's a direct analog to what happens in the book. But then conceptually too, I mean, all of us who are in that group for the recording, all of us, you know, we grew up listening to this music. And we've internalized a lot of the language, right, that Nate was talking about, that a lot of folks who come to music school are really entranced by. And in our conversations with each other and in making this, we wanted to perform some of that same labor we were just talking about. You know, we're here making music together now. In what ways can we contextualize this? To what and to whom are we indebted, right, as we're making this music?
Thank you so much. The first of our questions is coming from John Gennari, if you want to unmute and ask your question.
Thank you. First off, congratulations and just major thanks for this. This is really a watershed in jazz studies. You're going to push a lot of people working in the field to dream a lot more about what's possible and where things might go. I want to be really quick because I think there's some other questions that don't overlap quite so much with the conversation you had with Nate. It's just a question about finding the writing voice for the project and the organization of it. Now, in a certain sense, you know, with your three figures, there's a kind of built-in design element, but I imagine that solves one problem, but maybe create some others in terms of, you know, getting that kind of narrative through line that you want. So however you want to respond to that.
Well, thank you so much, John. I really appreciate that, and your work was definitely instrumental in me even thinking about how to approach Raúl Salinas's jazz criticism, for instance, and to contextualize that. In terms of the design of the book, And Charlie Kronengold read an earlier version of this before it was in its final full form. In the earlier version, the three stories that follow those three musicians were told more or less chronologically. And I was, when I had the headspace and the time to think about how to turn, you know, what was a study into something that was a narrative, a book, I realized that I didn't necessarily want to be beholden to biographical time. I wanted to find a way to foreground this dialogue between the present and what we call the past, right? Very much influenced, I guess, by Hayden White, right? The idea that the practical past, the past that you look to for wisdom. In terms of how to solve that problem, that's where, you know, the health condition at the time of my grandfather and my thinking about him, I guess, solved that design puzzle for me, which was, how would I tell a story the way he would? And is there a way to make that academically significant? And so that's what I was trying to do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Our next question is from Sarah Marcus, who unfortunately had to run out before we got to her. So I'm just going to read her question for you. She says, Jonathan, this project is so wonderful, and it's great to hear you talk about your process in putting it together. You mentioned listening relationally several times in your excerpts. Can you please talk a bit more about how you're conceptualizing this listening practice and what characterizes it?
Sure. I mean, intellectually, theoretically, it's something that is indebted to, I guess, two different related strands of thought or two different related discourses. One of them is, you know, the current conversations around not just comparative studies of race and ethnicity, for instance, but relational studies of race and ethnicity, and thinking about things like relational ontology. How are different categories constructed always already in relation to other categories, as opposed to distinct from them and then brought together through the act of comparison. So it's the act of bringing music into that conversation. But then, of course, you know, very much indebted to the scholarly work of Vijay Iyer, and even trying to break open the category of music itself, not just to think of it as a verb, but to think about you know, being situated as a listener in an environment, and what that means at the level of you're interfacing with other people, but you're interfacing with technology, you're interfacing with all aspects of the world around you. And my way of bringing all of that together was realizing that all of those things constitute a productive defamiliarization of these familiar categories. And what is more defamiliarizing than a dream? And so that's the figure that I landed on, and all of these conversations or theorizations of relationality ultimately funnel through that figure in this book.
Thank you. She also says she'll ask you more about this in Seattle. our next question is from Charles Groningold.
Hey, Jonathan, so good to see you. And yeah, thanks, Nate, and to you both for this wonderful conversation. I always liked the title, you know, but I never thought much of the dreams idea. And I usually feel like it's good readerly practice to ignore a writer's central metaphors. But hearing you talk about this just now in the like reading that part of the afterword made me really think that, you know, the dreams idea is doing some significant work in this book. So I'm saying, you know, is it fair to ask why you want to put dreams in the foreground of this book? Somebody put it in the chat. Now I lost my question. Dreams mean something different and specific to each of your three figures and to you, of course. How does the idea of dreams maybe bridge them? And, you know, how does this idea of dreams, you know, did it structure the book for you, though? Did it help you structure the book?
Yeah, well, that's a really important question, and one that the anonymous and, you know, very generous peer reviewers were asking me as well. So I think I was, because of the historical content, I was really concerned and interested in the idea of, you know, as one axis of this question, about complicating the sort of nation state mediated idea of an American dream. So from a political standpoint, you know, problematizing that language, and then taking that figure and then making it do a lot of different types of work, right? And I actually have, I'll share my screen one more time. I actually have an excerpt from the end of one of the chapters that I didn't think I was gonna use, but it seems appropriate for this, that maybe I can just put it up on the screen. Because this consolidates some of my thoughts on this. To dream in sound is to reveal the intimacy and strangeness of social and musical form. It's to attune oneself to relation, to vibrations linking bodies, surfaces, technologies, locations, and histories, to hear in unexpected resonances the traces of larger worlds. To dream among others, to listen for what worlds others hear, to sketch together new spaces of conviviality and covalness, is to invent new ways of relating and becoming, to challenge the subordination and anonymization that racial democracy and capitalism demand, to resist becoming reified as the tossed off, as the invisible, as the among others so often depersonalized and effaced. As Frantz Fanon writes, it's to strive to understand a group as such, to go beyond one's immediate existential being so as to apprehend the being of the other as a natural reality, to develop new names for the trembling worlds we're born into. It's to find truth in that making together. It's to share time. So short, maybe not the most linear answer to the question, but it's the one I have.
Great, thank you. The oft-quoted Scott Saul has a question next.
Thank you. Yeah, it's great to hear yourself, you know, take in little pieces of your writing and put in a more eloquent context than the original. So thank you for that, Jonathan. I really am looking forward to reading the whole book. I had a question. Just, you know, you have a lot of chops in a lot of different ways. And I personally just say, like, I felt writing my own book about jazz, like the hardest parts to write for me were the musical analysis. And maybe that's because I don't have as much training in musicology as you or other folks here do. But I also felt like there's an issue about, like, when you're engaging in this kind of forms of close analysis, where oftentimes it's harder to keep the narrative going.
Yeah.
You know, because it's like you're pressing the pause button and then you're abstracting out what this art object is so you can inspect it from different angles. Mm-hmm. And so I was just curious how, you know, and you talked about using these tools from jazz studies of transcription and so on, but how in the actual practice did you feel like, oh, I can model myself after this, what this person does, or did you feel like, oh, I'm doing something different because my project is so different? In the place of that kind of musical analysis within the project as a whole. For example, you know, say something like communal virtuosity, there's a lot of ways you can develop that biographically, talking about how people explain their relationship in an ensemble, but also the question of like, well, if I listen to a particular kind of music, can I describe, you know, by musical analysis, what that actually looks like, you know? So just was curious, you know, you've gone so much further than so many of us, and I wanted to hear what you've discovered in this process.
Thank you so much, Scott. That's high praise from somebody I admire. I think that, I mean, very practically speaking, I had the benefit in graduate school of being in a very, very quirky and very cool interdisciplinary humanities program. And so I got to work with Charles Crodingold, and we dove deep into a lot of different aspects of what music analysis can look like and feel like. But at the same time, I was also working with literary historians like Ramón Salivar and José David Salivar on aspects of cultural history and narrative analysis and things like that. And it has ended up into something that feels very unified, but in the act of making it, it's deep uncertainty. It is deep frustration. It is transcribing, you know, a ton of tunes and then having, sure, some scores, but it's like, what do I want to say about this? How does this add up to something? Where do I put this in the book? And I think a lot of it was trying to remain open to possibilities, again, to try to defamiliarize for myself what an academic book could do. And a lot of it too is informed by regularly being in conversation with and musical collaboration with musicians as well. And so the idea of communal virtuosity, and he cited in the book too, came from a fantastic experience as I was one of a few guest percussionists with the Harvard New Music Ensemble in December of 2021, with Taishan Sori guest conducting Autoskediasms, which is a piece that's like half composed, half improvised on the spot. And one of the things that emerged from that experience was this idea that that like the you have a group of people who have chops for days who can. You can play anything under the sun, but the piece that emerges from this is only going to succeed if everyone kind of doesn't try to make it about themselves, but rather uses what gifts they have to try to support others, to elaborate on what others have offered to the group. So then coming back to the, you know, very kind of solitary act of working on a book, a lot of it was just trying to think about what is that feeling that I had in that concert, on that performance. Is there a way that I can feel something similar when I'm working on this project? And then how do I get there?
Just to follow up on one more part of my question was just like, did you feel like you had a model?
Oh, right? Yes.
You know, we can turn to your work, but I'm curious what you were drawing from as the source.
So many models. At the level of musical analysis, I mean, again, Charlie's work was incredible. His attention to like the micro detail, I think, has always been very inspiring to me. Josh Kuhn's work, he's a mentor of mine now, and I've admired him for a long time. Vijay Iyer, of course, but also, you know, one of the major mentors that I had as a graduate student was Shadi Moraga, and so you know, she has tons and tons of, amazing life experiences to share with everybody. But one of the things that I remember her telling us in the workshop that we were completing with her was, if you feel it when you're creating what you're creating, then other folks will potentially. If you don't feel it, then they'll know. And so it's like, okay, can that be taken to the space of producing analysis? And that's where I was.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it.
Great, thanks. I'm just going to note that time is getting a little tight and we've got several more questions to get through. So on both askers and answerers sides, if we can try to just be conscious of that as we go. Christine Capitola, please ask your question.
Hi, thanks so much for this talk. I'll shorten it. I always type these very long prompts in the chat, but like someone else who already asked the question, I was really drawn to the idea of dreaming and particularly the phrasing post-national American dreaming. So I'm a Black queer sound studies person steeped in affect theory. So I think we've been talking about feeling now as the Q&A has unfolded, but I'm curious about how you might be theorizing that in this project or thinking ahead to other projects, like how this dreaming might happen around shared feeling through shared music. And then just a little shout out to the conversation Dan DiPiero and I did back in March. I see he's in the audience today about his book that just came out about improv and just appreciating these American studies approaches to jazz studies that have been coming out. So thanks for that too.
Yeah, thank you, Christine. And it's so great to see Dan here. He's also a drummer and very, very talented scholar and an amazing person. The phrase post-national American dreaming, again, it was coming out of, you know, the work I was doing with the historical content, but also in thinking about the present moment of writing the book, which was the bulk of the significant revisions happened in 2020. The world was on fire, you know, the movement for Black Lives was at its apex globally. And I was trying to figure out, you know, what to do with the desire for connection, right, to other folks. And I think that in terms of where I could see some of this going, difficult to forecast, but I think that at least from a historical standpoint, maybe attuning to archives that haven't been accessed before or haven't really, or to sources that haven't really been talked about before, thinking again about relationality from an onto-epistemological standpoint, as well as a political standpoint, and maybe also a narrative standpoint, I think could also all be useful for folks who are thinking, as you're saying, from within the traditions of Black feminist sound studies, of affect theory. It's a, you know, my very meat and potatoes kind of modest contribution, I think, to those discourses.
Okay, Nate has a question, but I'm going to skip him for a moment and make sure we get the people who haven't had a chance to speak yet in and hopefully come back to Nate. So Dan DiPiero, who's just been on everyone's lips, you had one.
That's very kind. Thanks, Jonathan. It's great to see you and great to hear this. I was just going to, you know, take advantage of the opportunity and ask you a little bit about the drums. Maybe, so this is coming out of a place of like, a question that I get often is like, how does your training as a musician affect your discipline as an academic, and particularly around writing, which you've talked a lot about. I always find it an incredibly difficult question to answer beyond the nuts and bolts training of like, well, I learned how to do transcriptions and there's some stuff that I know how to do now that I've been to school for it. But I'm thinking about it more on a conceptual level. So maybe you don't identify as a percussionist first, but that was my really first instrument. And I feel like I have this pet theory that we get trained to listen differently than other instrumentalists, for better and for worse. I'm wondering if that resonates with you, and if it does, how rhythm and your training as a percussionist show up in the book, how they shape your listening practices, your writing practices. Any reflections on that would be nice.
Yeah, man, I wish we had another hour. We could really, really dive into that. Yeah, I mean, I do think that folks who take up the drums as their primary instrument and they go through either standard, you know, Western or, you know, Western informed jazz studies education, you know, today or in other places, you definitely are listening in a different kind of way. You're listening to support mostly. You're listening to manage the flow of rhythmic energy and time. I think it's usually the incorrect thing to assume. And young students, you know, that I've worked with, you know, as a percussion, mentor or teacher, often have this mistaken idea that the times like stems from them and everybody has to listen to them, right? But so there are a lot of different avenues to that. In terms of how I think that it informs the work that I do, in particularly this book, I found myself thinking a lot about pacing, especially as I was oscillating between the past and the present in those different sections. You know, I was thinking about that. I was thinking at the level of the sentence, does this feel like it arrived somewhere? Like if this was a phrase, do I feel like I'm ending the phrase appropriately, or am I shortchanging it? Am I rushing it too much? And then at the level of the, I guess the narrative, the feeling of a historical moment, to try to connect what a polyrhythm feels like, right? These different things happening at different rates of speed, they have something to do with each other, but you don't necessarily know what they are, right? Maybe it's not just a 3 against 4, maybe it's a 27 against 39 against 74 against whatever. That feels like history, right? That feels like a lot of different elements happening that have something to do with each other, but are happening at different rates of speed, different periodicities. So metaphorically, analogically, that definitely informed the way that I was trying to deal with all of the stuff in the book.
We have another question about time that feels like it will tie in well. Aidan Levy, would you unmute and raise?
Hi, everybody. Sorry, I'm in the middle of cooking some pasta here and enjoying this conversation immensely. So yeah, my question is, I guess, about double time in this book, that we read about deep time, queer temporalities, chrononormativity, there's Eric Lott's double V, double time. Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering, what is the significance of double time to your project? How do you think about it here? And how does that kind of cross disciplinary boundaries?
It's a great question, Aidan. And I love your book, by the way. It was amazing.
Thank you.
So on the very, it functions in a lot of different ways. Double time as a immediate maybe signifier of bebop and its very brisk temporality. Usually if you're talking like meat and potatoes, you might hear chord changes happening at, you know, just for all practical purposes, like time one, and you might hear somebody like Charlie Parker or another musician soloing with note subdivisions that are twice as fast, or maybe even three times as fast, and building phrases according to that sort of subdivision. And that's at the heart of a lot of bebop music. It was when the 16th note, you know, became all the rage in a way that it hadn't before, maybe. But then at the from the perspective of the structure of the book, again, there is the past and the present. And so there is that kind of literalization of a double time. But then related to the musical form idea, there are different stories in the book that happen at different rates of speed. So there's the frame narrative that takes a pretty long, it's dilated, So it's really just the over the course of a few days, but it takes place, it frames the entire book. And then there are these compressed histories of these historical moments. And really, I think every historical project is built from those dilations and compressions, right? It's a texture, a mosaic of dilations and compressions. All histories are. It would be, I think, insanely boring to read a history that completely unfolded at, you know, at one rate of speed. And so again, that was, I guess, to go back to some of the main points from the conversation today, something that came from listening to this music. It was a musical idea that then changed the way that I thought about how to construct a historical project like this. So I hope that answers it.
Thanks very much. I think we're going to have to leave it there. I want to thank Nate and Jonathan very much for their time and their double time and their mosaics of time this afternoon and for this great conversation, and all of you for your questions and participation. And just remind you that next week on October 3rd, the same time, we'll have Ray Padgett coming on to talk about his book, Pledging My Time, conversations with musicians from various eras of Bob Dylan bands. So again, thank you everyone for coming.
Thank you all.